special case, all right, this is three special cases. Our polygon, our regular polygon is a square, it is equilateral triangle, and it is regular. So now we are taking right three particular cases. We can see on the screen also that square, equilateral triangle and regular hexagon. Now let us first take the square.
You can see on the screen.
Yes, I am taking now this. Yes, this is our square. You can see on the screen also. What are the rigid motions we can have here? All right, this is. There are. This is a n equal to 4. So this group is our D4, and it contains 8 elements. Which are the 8 elements? Let us see that part. All right. If we keep here in this way, and then we make the rotation, alright, of this in its plane by 0 degree, 90 degree, 180 degree and 270 degrees anti-clockwise. Alright, this is, then center will remain the fix. Not only center will remain the fix, but the final position also will remain the fix. That means rotation by 0 degree, 90 degree, 180 degrees and 270 degrees in anti-clockwise direction in the plane of the square will give us rigid motions. And we denote these rigid motions by R0, R1, R2 and R3. Now, what is R0? R0, we get it when we apply the motion by 0 degree. That means vertex A remains the same, vertex B also remains the same, vertex C remains the same, and vertex D also remains the same. And so we can describe this motion, alright, in this way also, by notations. We write down this as A, B, C, D, and A, B, C, D. That vertex A goes to A, B goes to B, C goes to C, and D goes to D. Now, when we make the rotation by anticlockwise rotation by 90 degrees, what we get is, we get the position like this. That means instead of the A, we get B, instead of place B, we get C, and so, that means our R1 will be A goes to B, B goes to C, C goes to D, and D goes to A. Same way, we can define R2 and R3. One more interesting thing what we get here is that if you take R2, then R2 comes up nothing but is equal to R1 composition R1, because it is 180 degrees, so 90 degree, again 90 degrees, and what we get is this part. And if you take, I can denote this by R1 square. And R3 comes out nothing but is equal to R1 cube. And if you take now, alright, R1 raised to 4. Alright, this is, that means we have again the original positions, and that means it comes out nothing but is equal to R0. I am writing all the things here in detail because in our next lecture, alright, these properties are going to be very useful, alright, in the study of our study. So these are the four, alright, what we get is by rotations. Now, we get, let us take this now. And now, we make revolution in space about the diagonal RS. Then under diagonal RS, A goes to C and C goes to A goes to B and B goes to D. All right, this is the H. All right, this is, then take this. Again, the line PQ joining the midpoints of AC, AD and BC. If we take the revolution again, this, what we get is A goes to B, B goes to A, B goes to C, and C goes to B. That we denote by V. One thing, very interesting thing comes here is this, that suppose we take V, again we apply V. Then again what happens is, first we take the reflection, revolution about the diagonal PQ, again we take the revolution along the diagonal here, we get the same original position. That means what we get is H square is comes out nothing but equal to R0, and V square also comes out nothing but is equal to R0. Now we take revolution about our diagonal AC, where we take the revolution about diagonal in the space along the diagonal AC, A remains same, C remains same, while B goes to D and D goes to B. We denote this by D1. Similarly, if we take the revolution in space along the diagonal BD, then B remains the same, D remains the same, A goes to C and C goes to A. One thing more, if I again take the revolution about BD, then again C will go to this original position, A will go to his original position, and so what I get is that D1 square is also is equal to R0 and D2 square is also is equal to R0. And now we can see this group table for this on screen. Yes, that is what we can get here is, I have shown the relation also, but we can derive all these things with the help of this our table. Okay, now we take equilateral triangle. We have equilateral triangle ABC. O is the center of gravity, that means the three perpendicular AR, BP and CQ meets. And if you see that each of this angle is 120 degrees. And so the first rigid motions we get is that we denote by R0, alright, rotation in its plane by 0 degree. Then we denote it by R1, the rotation in anticlockwise direction in its plane by 120 degrees, anticlockwise direction. And R2, alright, anticlockwise rotation, alright, in its plane by 240 degrees. Again, we have relation same way here is that R2 comes out as R1 square and R1 cube comes out nothing but is equal to R0. This is an equilateral triangle. So this is our notation is D3, dihedral group of degree 3. It contains 6 elements. Out of the 6 elements, we have already obtained 3 elements, R0, R1 and R2. Now let us take this perpendicular bisector AR and rotate this, like this is in space along this. Then what will happen is A will remain the fix and B will go to C and C will go to B. This we denote by A. Similarly, if we take B and if we take this perpendicular back surface of BP and rotate in its place, all right, this is, then B remain fixed, A goes to C and C goes to B, we denote this by B. And finally, all right, taking rotation in space along this diagonal perpendicular bisector CQ, we get rigid motion AC. Again, it is very simple for all of us to see that if you take A square, B square, C square, then what we get is nothing but is equal to R0. And we can see this, all right, on the screen on group table for this. Yes, this is what we can get it, that R0, R1, R2, A, B, and C. Now finally, we have a regular hexagon. In regular hexagon, all right, this is, we have 6 vertices A, B, C, D, E, and F. I'm just giving you some hints here that what are the rigid motions here we get. Anti-clockwise rotations by 0 degree, 60 degree, 120 degrees, 180 degrees, 240 degrees. All right, this will give you the rigid motions, and we denote this by R0, R1, R2, R3, and R4, and R5. Now, we take the opposite sides and we take the midpoints joining their opposite sides. And we take the revolution about of this hexagon in space about this. Then what happens is E goes to D, F goes to C, A goes to B, B goes to A, and this. We get 3 of this type. One along here, this diagonal, on midpoint joining this. Second is here, and third is here. We denote this by H1, H2, and H3. And finally, we take this diagonal AD. Again, we take the revolutions along this diagonal. What will happen? A and D will remain the same. F goes to B, B goes to F, E goes to C, and C goes to A. In the same way, we have taken one diagonal, we can take other two diagonals also, and what we get is, we get 3 other elements, B1, D2, and D3. Here, it is a regular hexagon, and so our notation, it is a dihedral group of order 6. Number of elements are 12, and these are the 12 elements. I hope that student will prepare a table for this, but I want to note one thing only, and I will stop my lecture here, is that if you take H1, H2, H3, if you take their square, you get R0. Same thing about D1, D2, D3 also, that D1 square, D2 square, D3 square comes out equal to the original position, that is R0. And finally, we can find out the relation between R1, R2, R3, R4, and 5. Thank you. It's okay?